Agreed.
Mills? A bunch of them were. What are you, a janitor?
Sorry.
That's not nervous.
Sharon.
Yeah.
Okay. We now call the meeting to order, regular council meeting of September the 8th. Welcome everybody, and nice to be back in the saddle again, eh? Second item on the agenda, approval of agenda, or does anybody have anything to add to the agenda, or? If not, I'll entertain a motion to approve. Moved by Councillor Book and seconded by Councillor
Muse.
To approve the agenda as circulated. All those in favour signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carried. Are there any conflict of interest from anybody around the table on any of the items on the agenda? Hearing none, we'll go on. The next item on the agenda is presentation, and I welcome Carol Hill Boharski, the Yarmouth Food and Wine Extravaganza Society. And could put your mic on so we.
Okay, I have a little green light. Does that mean it's on already?
Yes.
Yes.
Should be all set.
Can you hear this? Is that good?
I don't know.
Okay, great.
Yeah, yes.
So hi, everybody. My name is Carol Hill Boharski, and I am one of the directors of the Yarmouth Seafood and Wine Extravaganza Society. Now, I understand that you did have presentation that I did at another council, just for your information. But the presentation that I have here this evening is a presentation to ARGA. So, the Yarmouth Seafood and Wine Extravaganza just finished its fourth year. It began as a one-time event originally scheduled during the 250th year celebrations and has since morphed into a three-day festival held on our beautiful waterfront and at the Rod Grand Convention Center. The dates of this year's events were August 7th, 8th, and 9th. Our mission, however, remains the same, and that is to celebrate our world-class seafood and local beverages and to highlight the incredible hospitality of our communities and surrounding areas. Each year, we have sought to improve and increase the awareness of events and add to the hospitality of our community. This year, the board and committee wanted to add waterfront competitive boat races, music, and the addition of a rising star demo chef. We were able to add the competitive boat races and music, and our rising star chef is on tap for 2016. The waterfront boat races were a costly addition. To bring the races to Yarmouth as part of a competitive race boat circuit had a price tag of $7,000, plus the addition of security, trophies, and costs to logistics. There was a one show in the afternoon taking place after the Fabulous Fish Fiesta on Saturday, August the 8th, in the runner's tent. During the Fish Fiesta, the racers were available to visit the tent, talk with the spectators, and also be available after the completion of races and the awards presentation. They did take a number of spectators for cruise down the harbor and after the races were completed. And I have a picture of that was taken by the Vanguard, showing what the boat races are, in case you didn't have a chance to take a look at that. And it's on this page and the second page. Okay, the race boats traveled to Yarmouth from Shelburne area, performed the competition in the harbor to thousands of spectators on shore. We then had the opportunity to present winners with their awards. Yarmouth is now part of the provincial race boat competitive circuit. In future, the ideal situation would be to charge a fee to view the competition, but location does not permit. We will investigate, however, further to see if there is any possible way. The Fabulous Fish Fiesta event expanded this year by providing local nonprofit groups and organizations the opportunity to work together, sample some amazing seafood, and show off to one another and to our community and over 2,000 guests who sampled the food, another of our greatest assets, again, our hospitality. However, we are always looking to add to the list of the VON Tri-County, the Rotary Club, the Knights of Columbus, the Yarmouth County Museum, Le Village, and the Shark Scramble. And we are hoping to welcome two newcomers next year, the Wedgeport Tuna Museum and the Abuptic Festival. Music was also added to the tent on Fish Fiesta Saturday, and we are looking to add Rendezvous de la Bay musicians for next year. The festival begins on Friday with the VON Tri-County Surf or Turf Dinner, and that is an or dinner. It's one or the other, lobster or steak, and has turned out to be their largest fundraiser of all the fundraisers they have over the year, and this is Tri-County for the second year in a row. On Saturday, we have the Fabulous Fish Fiesta for nonprofit groups and organizations, where all the money raised is returned to each organization. This year was the largest return to date. On Sunday is the Seafood and Wine Extravaganza at the Rod Grand Hotel. The convention area is packed with the restaurants, wineries, breweries, cider distributors, distiller, three celebrity chefs doing demos in a professional setting, and a celebrity host for the evening. Time is 6 to 8:30. All evening, we are also give away gift certificates to enjoy the participating restaurants at a later date. It is very busy with 175 guests sold out all year since the beginning, sampling all the different seafood and beverages. Atlantic Superstore is our largest sponsor, contributing to all of the groups and nonprofits and food vendors and donating non-alcoholic beverages and staff to serve them. Atlantic Superstore also is a permanent sponsor of one of the Yarmouth Harbor Cup trophies for the 550 horsepower category of the boat races. Marie GM is a permanent sponsor of the Yarmouth Harbor Cup trophy for the 400 horsepower category. And Tuscat Altamar is the permanent sponsor of the Yarmouth Harbor Cup for the 40 horsepower category. Their sponsorship is very much appreciated. The Yarmouth Harbor Cups can be displayed in each of these businesses during the year and will be presented next year to the new winners. Plaques with the winning boat name will be added to each cup for each year. This year, Yarmouth and Acadian Shores sent a professional videographer to the extravaganza on Sunday to make a video that will be used to advertise culinary events not to be missed in Nova Scotia during the coming year. As well, 2016 will be the Seafood and Wine Extravaganza's fifth year and an anniversary year. The Society is looking to be even bigger and to add to the festivities significantly again for next year. Also, I will send the link to you of the YouTube video produced by Yarmouth and Acadian Shores, and I'll ask Chris if he wouldn't mind passing that along to you. And please pass it along to everybody you know, just saying. In closing, the Society wishes to thank you for your sponsorship toward the boat races for this year. And since the boat races are now a permanent part of the extravaganza, we are hoping to have your continued support and sponsorship for the coming year in the amount of $3,000, the same amount the Society will be requesting from the town and the municipality and district of Yarmouth to support the fifth annual and anniversary year of the Yarmouth Seafood and Wine Extravaganza. Come, eat, learn, and enjoy the hospitality. We are currently working on a new budget for 2016, and we'll pass that along to you as soon as possible. Thank you for your time and your consideration.
Thank you very much, Carol. Anybody have any questions for Carol?
I also have cards, and they are this is just a, the one that was, this was the advertising for this year for the Seafood and Wine Extravaganza, which was located out here in your lobby. However, we now have so much stuff going on that it's way too busy, so we have to separate out everything for next year. We're going to separate it into events and days. Might make it a little easier, because at this point, it's just a entire conglomeration of letters and words. After you read the first event, you're like finished looking at it. So mm-hmm. we are redoing everything for as far as everything goes for next year. Okay.
Okay.
Cards, anybody? Cards.
Yes, pass them around. Good.
Any questions?
No. I'll take a card.
Good presentation. There's no questions, Carol.
Oh, I don't know if that's good. That yeah. might be like, okay, honey, bye-bye. Oh,
no, we were listening.
No, I enjoy things up here.
Yeah.
Not a lot of people.
It did.
Yeah, there.
We're extremely proud because we had very little time to do any of the advertising for the boat races. Like, literally very little time. Yeah. So we did have thousands of people. We have... I cannot give you an accurate number, but I was assured by the Vanguard that it was 5,000 plus. So
oh, yeah.
that's a large that's a large amount of people to bring for a single event.
Good, good.
A lot of people, and for the VON.
Yes. Absolutely, absolutely. Everything. Yeah. Last year they ran out of lobsters. One didn't have, there wasn't one, not even to be gathered at the restaurant. They took all the restaurant lobsters last year. And this year they were, there was like, people were coming to the door and they were saying, oh, I'll have to check if there's food. I'll have to check if there's food. So that's always a wonderful sign when that happens.
I volunteer to eat.
Did you? Oh, you need to come eat at my table. That's what I volunteer to do at that event.
Yeah.
It's a great deal.
Yes.
It's $15 for a lobster or a steak, and it has a salad and a roll and
really
homemade
good.
Sweets. And
yeah, and the volunteers, really second to none. They're the best
Absolutely. Terrific volunteers.
Well, thank you very much.
All right,
no questions.
Thank you.
Thank you for your presentation. And
do I sit or do I leave? What do I do?
That's up to you. You're welcome to stay. We're probably not going to discuss this tonight.
No, I'm sure you
but,
won't.
But, you know, you can stay and listen or for or our meeting, could. Or you can leave. It's either way. And,
okay.
And we won't be offended if you leave. So.
Okay.
So.
Well, it can't be that bad. Is it all right if I stay?
Yes. Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Next item on the agenda is adoption of minutes, and the first one is the regular council of June the 30th.
So moved.
Second.
It's moved and seconded. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carried. Next one is a special council meeting of July the 15th.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carried. And the special council of August the 18th.
So moved. Second.
Moved in stereo. And seconded. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carried. Business arising from the minutes. First one we have here is dangerous or unsightly policy review. Who's going to talk? You or Chris? You, okay. CAO will direct us through that.
Okay, so at our last meeting, or the meeting before that, there's actually, sorry, Mr. Warden, there's an attachment under
yes,
number five. You may have to refresh.
Oh.
just right at the number 5. I didn't want to miss that.
Oh, okay. Oh, okay. No, I didn't have that. I didn't refresh, I guess. Well, you want to do that first?
Sure.
Okay.
So the document is a 3-page document. It's a report on business arising from the minutes. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 items listed here. The first is municipal administration building. There's actually additional information in the CAO report, so I'll defer to that if you don't mind. Under private roads, at our last meeting, we had a discussion around whether or not this municipality should take over roads that meet a certain technical specification. If that was an interest of council, that we'd have to do some policy change. What you asked staff to do is to get additional information, one around legal, some of the potential liability associated with road ownership, which I think we could speak about, you know, in a fairly general sense. We have not received, a brief note on the insurance risks associated with private road ownership. We also contacted the Department of Transportation. That was the other outstanding issue. Councillor Muse had in his previous employ, had experience with how some of these roads got taken over in the past, and that they were actually reviewed and inspected with the Department of Transportation. So when private roads were being constructed, that was an intention to pass over to the province. The province actually was part of that inspection process. So we have yet to receive information on the one road in question, which was the Montague Road. We had asked the department to determine whether or not they actually did that back in the early 90s. So we're waiting for that information. So I think, you know, we haven't gotten the information at your request. Certainly, if you wish to discuss it here now, it would be continued discussion from the last meeting. I know you deferred the any sort of decision based on at least those two things. So I don't know, Mr. Chair, what you want to do, whether or not you want to open that discussion now, or whether you feel that it should be, we should wait for that information, or it's entirely up to council.
Well, I suppose we might as well wait for the information. We don't have any more information than we had the last time we discussed it.
No.
Let's table that.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it'll remain on business arising until we get that information. We'll be more aggressive to try to get that information, follow up.
Mm-hmm.
Also, we did correspond with the residents of the Montague Road, specifically the one resident that wrote on behalf of the Montague Road residents, expressing concern around the lack of municipal services. So we responded and explained where we have gotten to this point around the busing and some of the challenges with busing. So they've received that correspondence. We've also corresponded with Gordon Amiro, the owner of the road itself, in efforts to obtain additional information around whether or not there's additional information on a proof of engineered design, which would be extremely helpful to us in making kind of a decision. So, and I think I mentioned, and I'm repeating myself a little bit, I said told me not to talk, and now I'm talking about it. I am repeating for the benefit of Councillor Bourque, who was not able to make the last meeting. In order for the municipalities to take over these roads, they do have to be constructed at a certain standard in accordance with the Municipal Government Act. So it's not just a question of, we'll take it anyway. We're actually, there's a legislative control around that. So,
mm-hmm.
Okay. I'll continue. Dangerous and unsightly premise is actually attached to an item a little later on, so we'll just
John
there.
Sullivan's report?
Correct.
Yeah.
And then the procurement policy by local, council had asked staff to look at changing the wording to allow for additional opportunities for local organizations to, I guess, to change the wording so that our policy will be more lenient towards a buy local situation within a certain price range. And so that work has not been completed yet, but it's here. We haven't forgotten. It's
okay.
On the books. There's an attachment to the agenda responding to your letter request asking YASTA to look into the visitor information center located at the Halifax waterfront. So YASTA will be meeting on the 15th of September. And that meeting, it's from what I understand, it's been a very positive reception on the part of YASTA. And so they'll have to bring it to their board for official approval. And that's what I know about that.
Mm-hmm.
So the correspondence is attached. And that's it for that report.
Okay.
Unless there are questions on that.
Any questions to CAO? If not, we'll go on to dangerous and unsightly. You want to touch on this now?
Sure. So this is, we're not asking council to make a decision on the policy today. What we're looking for from council is to make sure that we're on the right track. Because whenever we do policy amendments, we'd like to first check in with you to make sure that it's consistent with what you might think, with what you were thinking when you first gave us the work to do. So this was added yesterday, so I'll spend a little time around the details. So you've asked us to look at how we're going to increase our inspections or deal with more dangerous and unsightly properties,
mm-hmm,
at the request of certain residents. And so what we've done is we've taken a look at what we do now and what our policy looks like now. Certainly, I think at the last meeting I indicated we don't take a proactive approach. We rely on a complaints process. There's a reason why we do that, but there isn't a reason why we couldn't investigate a proactive approach. So that's where we started. So there's three things that staff considered when we had discussions. One is that you want to beautify your community. That's what you'd like to see. You'd like to see some of these properties get better. Second, there's a number of reasons why properties become unsightly and dangerous, and some of that is financial reasons. So we have to be conscious of that. Our community is our community, and so we have to try to find ways to work with people of varying means. And so that was considered. Also, the third is that the improved service should not come at a considerable cost to the residents. I think the residents expect that we do this work and try to find a way to do it within our means. So that's the assumptions that we took when we're bringing these alternative or these changes to your attention. So the three areas that we there are some budget and cost considerations when it comes to dangerous and unsightly cleanup, but they're not necessarily our costs, right? 80% of the time, they're actually the resident actually is response in a very positive way. Sometimes they're not aware. And so they respond and say, look, sorry, we got a little out of hand, we'll clean it up, no problem. So in a lot of situations, that's what happens. So in order to determine what the cost is for us, it's difficult to assess. So we're trying to keep the costs low. So one of the things that we wanted to look at is if we're gonna do a proactive approach, we can't do it all the time. So one of the recommendations would be to identify maybe a two-a-year situation, not in our busy construction season, so that we can utilize some of our existing resources in an effective way. Also, we're looking at focusing perhaps on certain roads in certain communities rather than going in the some of the back roads where even if there is unsightly, people can't actually see it, so maybe it's not an issue. Dangerous is always an issue. However, in our policy, what we're saying is if we're going to proactively go and seek out these properties, that we would restrict that work to a certain amount, to a certain amount of communities per session, or we would look at doing only certain roads on a regular basis. So the advantage of doing that, of course, is seeing properties today and tomorrow. So if there's an improvement, or if there's, you know, a disrepair situation's getting worse, right? So we can't know that unless we actually look at it and look at it and look at it. So so we would look for very specific things. The responsibility to assess whether it's unsightly would remain with John Sullivan, our dangerous and unsightly representative. He's been designated to do this work. It would be his call. Unless it comes to demolition, then it comes to council. Right, so that's the policy. The other changes would be to include the current definition of dangerous and unsightly, and that can be done, you know, either the full definition MGA or a smaller version of that for the proactive approach. You can actually you can focus your efforts. You know, you could focus the staff through your policy around, well, look, like if we're going to go proactive, we're looking for this, and this. And you can do that. Okay. And then the others, well, you'll still get complaints from other properties in disrepair, and we would continue to treat those exactly the same way as we've done in the past. Mm-hmm. So the other thing that we're looking at for policy changes is the order of priority. So that's kind of the same point, is that, you know, maybe we're more concerned with properties that are very visual, right? That are very close to the road. Those are usually the ones in our experience that we get complaints about, that they're very visual. They're on a corner and everybody sees everything, right? There's a lot of properties that might be unsightly, you just don't know it, you know. But some of those are very, they're more difficult. I think communities don't like to see that in there. So that's the work we've done so far. And we just wanted to check in and say, okay, is this, so what we're saying is probably twice a year, proactive approach, using existing staff resources, making a list of properties on those roads in those communities, contacting them proactively, saying, look, there might be an issue here, and then seeing if they will solve their own issue, and then when we go back in the spring or fall, it would be a follow-up, and then if it's a continued issue, then we would treat them just as if it was a complaint, and then we would put them through our system where we have official warnings, etc., that you have seen happen. Okay. So that's a lot of information.
Thank you, Councillor Leblanc. Did you have something?
Yes, I do. I can't speak for all of council, I guess, but just certainly myself. I feel like I may have been misinterpreted when I spoke on this issue. I wasn't concerned as much on being proactive in identifying the problematic areas. Seems like the public does that for us, or at least even we can. I mean, we drive through our communities, we see problematic areas. My issue is the system from the moment an issue is identified to the moment the issue is remedied. It seems like everything always drags on. I understand you have to give the landowner time to do his diligence, of course. You can't just go down tearing down houses instantly, but it seems to me that often we're hampered by what we can do, and that's sort of what I wanted addressed, so that when there's a clear issue, when there's a barn with the roof caved in that children can go running, it's dangerous and it's unsightly. I know there's issues with defining dangerous and unsightly, but it's the time frame and the amount of power for say that we have in remedying these situations. I'd like to see less time and probably stricter rules on how you maintain your lot, whether it be a building or a derelict car or something like that.
Thank you.
OK.
Councillor Surratt?
I like everybody else, I read the report. I think this is great, what you've come up with, what the staff and the people in Public Works and wherever's worked on it. This I found it really good. I really like the idea of twice a year, visual, looking around. I didn't see anywhere where it addressed people making complaints. The procedure, is that it just a, this is not in our policy, it's probably something, and here I'm just guessing, is it just something Public Works said that if somebody has a complaint, they have to write their name down, who made the complaint, and blah, 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 because that was an issue, people, I remember bringing this at the last meeting, that people, you know, they have to put their name on a paper, they don't have somebody going to come after them and burn their house down. I mean, that was actually told to me by a couple of people that, you know, these people, you know, so I don't see that being addressed. So, like, how to handle it? It seems it's just a policy by Public Works themselves. It is not in this policy at all. And I don't see where that's addressed.
It isn't addressed in the modifications. No. It is already in the policy.
What okay, we do. I didn't.
And so I
didn't read below.
So it's 3.3A of the
Thank
policy.
You, Alain.
No, it's okay. It says, in circumstances where a complaint is received, yeah, whereby premises are described as being dangerous and unsightly, the following procedure shall be followed. The complaint shall be received in writing by the administrator and duly documented. So that's where we insist upon it being a serious complaint. Now, I think the issue, to your point around the privacy piece,
yeah,
I think people are concerned that their name's going to be out there and
yes,
that they're going to
yes,
be subsequently, you know, something's going to happen.
Yes.
Well, that name is private information. So
it
we
is
don't,
private in, okay.
We don't share that information. However, the policy does not say that specifically.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I think we would take that back and take a look at, you know, how do we protect people who want to improve their communities but are too scared to submit a complaint. Now, the other thing that we said also was that there was nothing in the policy that said that the councilor
yes,
could make a complaint. And so you could make a complaint on behalf of a resident.
Very
and
good.
So it would be you're attached to it anyway,
oh,
as council.
Okay. Yeah.
So that might be a way to
yes,
alleviate some concerns of the neighbors.
Right.
However, it doesn't you know, when you do a complaint process like that, it doesn't preclude the opportunity or the person, the property owner, to say, well, it must have been this person, right?
Yeah.
It doesn't stop that, unfortunately.
No.
But your point is well taken, and I think when we change that policy, we need to probably
increase
the language to see if we can protect the person complaining.
Right.
The reason why we ask for serious complaints is because there is a process. There's a legal process that happens potentially when somebody isn't going to clean their property properly.
Yeah.
And so we don't want that process to be damaged in any way. And we want serious complaints.
Yes.
So if somebody passes by a house and, you know, they could just this house is messy, sign no one. You know, and so that's not really somebody that's serious about wanting to clean it. But I get the issue
yeah,
around the fear,
yeah,
and I think we should address that for sure.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Albright?
I'm just thinking that if we took this proactive approach, and let's say John Sullivan is out there kind of scanning certain streets, certain roads, whatever, I think that might alleviate some of the issues, right? Because he would identify those properties rather than having somebody phone us to make that complaint. So that might be, you know, something that's helpful for that.
Makes sense.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you.
Deputy Warden.
And I agree with the proactive way of doing this. I'm just wondering about if we become proactive, then there'll be more, I guess, residents more houses or whatever that are out there, you know. So how we're gonna have to reflect this in the budget too,
mm-hmm,
because if we become really proactive, it could snowball. So I'm sure you've taken that into consideration.
Yes, and so when we talk about costs, you know, typically when we force people to clean their properties, which you have the right to do, that cost gets put on their tax bill. However, there are still costs that, that remain with the municipality. And in some cases, you know, those costs, I mean, you know, you've seen situations where we've demolished properties and it's like $12,000. And so, you know, $12,000 gets added to the property, and if the land has little value, there's very little you can do to recover that, even if the person says, you know what, I don't want that property anymore.
That's right.
So in some cases we've been very successful where the property's been very nice, and once you demolish, it's a beautiful property and eventually went to tax sale and got picked up by community, and that's a great story because they probably got the piece of land for less than its value, you know, in essence, and we were able to deal with an issue. So that's like the best case scenario. Well, the best case scenario is actually we tell a resident that their property is unsightly and they just clean it. And you know, in 70% to 80% of the time, that's what happens. And in some cases, they're not even aware. There might be a renter that has caused the property to go into disrepair. Sometimes there are seasonal properties. So there's a variety of reasons why these things go the way that they go.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, we don't want to assume. And the advantage of the proactive is that you can actually contact these people in a nice way and say, look, your property's, you know, sometimes you get a positive response.
Yeah.
Right?
Councillor LeBlanc, then another.
Yes, I don't mean to speak twice on this issue.
That's all right.
I just would like to clarify, although I feel there is a need to amend the situation from, like I said, recognizing there's a problem to amending the problem, I do, however, agree with being proactive. I should mention that I don't disagree with what you've wrote here. I just feel like there is something that could be added to the process. Touching on what Councillor D'Ottimo said, it may end up costing the municipality a few more dollars for sure if this does snowball. However, from my point of view, from the taxpayers I represent, I feel like that would be money well spent, and if adjustments to the budget are needed, it's a serious issue, especially in my area. Derelict houses and things like that. So I just want to clarify that I don't disagree with what you've added here. I actually fully agree. However, I think there could be more, that's all.
Thank you.
So just as a what I've heard from Councillor LeBlanc is that it's not so much, it's the time it takes from the time it starts to the time it finishes, and what I can do for you is actually get the stats on that, so that we're actually talking about,
yeah,
you know when they start, when they finish, and sometimes that you don't, you know, most of them don't come back here, so you may not know how fast or how slow.
Yeah.
So I know right now we have two orders to demolish that are outstanding, that are on your agenda as a notice, as a bit of a warning, that might come to your council's attention. And ironically, they're both in your community. So maybe we'll have a different conversation next month. But I hear that. But I think let's get the evidence and bring it back here and take a look. And we can look at it year to year and see if we're getting better or worse.
Sure. Okay.
Yeah, sure.
Thank you.
Yeah, it will.
Yeah.
Okay, so I think there's a motion, recommended motion on this, unless there's other changes.
Oh yes.
So just to review what I've heard, stricter rules on existing process, or at least a better understanding of how fast it goes. Address the fear of reprisal,
yes.
And I think that's it. Did I miss one?
And what is the suggested motion you're looking for?
Suggested motion is on the
page.
Council moves to direct staff to amend policy C13, dangerous and unsightly premises, with the proposed amendment as presented by the director of the department of property inspection and public works.
That's right.
And that would be with these sole amendments. Will that be overlooked anytime soon? I just need clarity here, that's all.
I think what the motion should say is that, and anything else that you wish staff to amend. So to your point around examining the time frame,
complaints.
That would have, if you want that to be addressed in the amendments, then I think you'd want to add that to the motion.
Depending on who makes the motion.
Yeah, depending on who makes the motion.
I guess what I'm getting at is I'm not comfortable making a motion approving this and solely this. I feel like staff has more homework to do, so I would like to defer is what I'm getting at.
I like Councilor Blanc, I feel the same way. Come back next meeting and bring some of the stuff you wrote down.
This isn't exactly pressing, in my opinion.
Yeah.
It doesn't have to be done today, and I feel like it's missing.
Well, it's not approving.
That's what I'm asking. Is this approving the
No, it's a.
What it's saying to staff is take these changes and any other changes that you've suggested here today, put it in a policy amendment. You have to pass the policy. So what would happen is we would put the document together, we would bring it to your attention.
Yes.
And at that point, you can either decide to defer, amend, reject, etc.
Thank you.
I'd like to move that we direct staff to amend the policy C-13, dangerous and unsightly premises, with the proposed amendments, which we've got the time frame, and the CAO, you've got a couple of other things you wrote down.
Yes.
The complaints procedure, I guess, of who can send in that was one more item there.
Protection of privacy.
Protection of privacy, yes. And that goes in there.
Okay.
Do we have a seconder?
Second.
Any more questions or comments? Or?
Okay, yeah. Mr. Clerk.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carried. Okay, good. Next item is Joint Regional Tourism Marketing Initiative. That yours?
That's just the correspondence supporting the upcoming YASTA meeting.
Yes.
There's no decision to be made there.
Yes. Okay. Okay. Just for information. Next item is a warden's report. Probably all had a chance to read it. Have any questions or comments? Or I didn't mention on there that I attended the closing ceremonies of the tuna tournament, along with some of the other councillors here, and I'm sure somebody will report on that. Councillors' reports. Does anybody have a report to make? Councillor Surratt?
Just a few items. It's been a busy summer like everybody else around the table here. Festival de Barge went well. There's a lot of participation. They had a nice supper. They much appreciate the money that we council sent their way in the form of the grant. And it was well attended. A lot of people at when they made the barge. Also, just another thing I'd like to say that our waste park, the waste park authority at the transfer station, we moved the motion at our last meeting last week that we approved that Skoka Recycling is okay to relocate their building from the airport to the waste park, so that they can move to bring their budget to their people to build a new building. It's under $1 million, the building, and that'll bring them right at the waste park, less traveling. It's Synergy Energies, where we're the waste park. They've got all the recyclables. Instead of transferring some of the recyclables that are contaminated, they have to bring it to the waste park, truck it there. That'll be some money saved on that point. So this is moving along well, and it's a good move. And we'll wait to hear probably next month of what their board says on this new building. We'll be leasing it for $1 for 19 years and 11 months and 29 days. Got to be under 20 years apparently for legal reason, but anyhow, about subdivisions or something like that. Anyhow, so it's, like I said, it's a dollar. The land is there. It belongs to the three partners. And we all believe, the board all believe it's a good move. And so we'll be hearing further once we hear from Skoka Recycling, probably in the next month. And that's it.
Thank you. Any questions on that? Councillor LeBlanc?
Like I already mentioned, I like to comment on the tournament that I attended. Well-attended tournament. It seems like the tournament gains success every year. Take a second to congratulate Luke and Jerry Cottrell for winning the tournament this year with a, if I remember correctly, 656-pound bluefin
right.
this year.
Yeah.
I think they were quite content with that. Great tournament, but I would like to, however, mention I think how much the Tuna Tournament and the museum appreciated council's grant that we give each year. And sometimes I've heard a few comments that because the tournament is successful in generating revenue for the tournament that's then given to the museum, how come they need grant money type thing. But on a year like this year, of course, we're always mindful that weather may cause an issue and cancel the whole tournament, and that there's costs that are occurred through the year that cannot be returned. But however, this year, for whatever reason, although the intention is to get a bluefin, we often generate, or the tournament often generates, sorry, a large amount of money through bycatch of albacore and big eye tuna. And this year, there was a few caught, but basically to say none to speak of. So although most of the boats did get their bluefin in a certain area, there was a significant reduction in revenue. Of course, the numbers aren't out yet. I have no idea what they are, but I can only assume. So it was very successful. The turnout was great. The participation was great. However, the fishing was quite a bit less. So it shows in years like this that it takes every aspect that goes into the tournament to make it work, to make it viable. So councils... donation through our grants organization program was I think greatly appreciated from everyone that's involved with that tournament. So I think you know, we should be proud to have been able to put on such a fantastic show in our municipality that I'm sure brought people from all over the world. I know it has. Just at the closing ceremonies, I think participants were pointed out from where they were coming from, and it's quite nice to see how people came from all four corners of the world just to see this tournament. So that's all.
Good, thank you. Yeah, it's a big event.
It's huge.
Huge, yeah. Councillor Albright?
I just wanted to mention about the multipurpose court at Echo Belleville. It is almost ready, but not quite. The fencing, there's still some fencing that needs to go up. There was a lot of work going on in July, and then it seemed to be a bit of a lull in August. So it's coming along, but it's not quite ready yet. Yeah.
Yeah, I drove by there. It looks good. Yeah. Thank you. Deputy Warden?
And speaking of multi-purpose courts, I've gone a few times and inspected the one in West Pumlico. I haven't... I've seen pictures of the Wedgeport, the two tennis courts that look, you know, really nice. But the guys from Quebec who are doing the job assured me that the court in the multi-purpose court in West Pumlico was going to be nicer than Wedgeport.
Oh, my God.
And I see Lucien just walked out. But anyway. but, and I the tennis court, you know, a tennis court is a tennis court. But the multi-purpose part, which is basketball and handball, has all kinds of different colors, and it really is nice. And they've done a really good job. They're not done yet. They've got fencing. They've got, you know, a few things to fix. But I went over there, and it's a company from Quebec, and was doing this job. And for about 20 minutes, two of them talked my ear out at the same time to explain to me the process and how they were, you know, doing it and the time frame and everything. It was actually quite interesting how they do it. I can't explain it here, but it should be up and running pretty soon. So, yeah.
Yes, I checked it out this week. Still a little bit of work to get done, but it looks really nice.
It's sharp.
Floor. Yeah, very sharp. And I've gone there quite a few weeks ago. They were just starting to fix it up, and. Had quite a chat with him, too.
Warden Dostrom, are you going to buy a tennis racket now? Or?
I have one.
Okay, you have one. Okay, I guess I'll have to buy one, and we'll
yeah.
have to challenge
you. Oh, yeah. yeah, imagine. anybody else have a report? Not. We'll go on to the CAO's report.
I heard it. I could feel it. I sensed that Councillor Murphy wanted me to spend a long time on this report. This report was distributed, a couple days ago. So I think most of this information there's a lot of information in this report. Just want to give a couple of quick updates. One on aquaculture. So tomorrow we have a meeting with the province of Nova Scotia. They're coming in. We'd been delayed through the summer. They had a lot of legislative work that they needed to do before they could, look at our project. So they'll be meeting with us tomorrow, and with the idea of determining what kind of information do we have around our waters and whether or not they're suitable. And so what we want to do is make sure that if there is, potential growth in this industry, that we do it in a way that the community is engaged. And so we can do that better than the province can. We can talk to our stakeholders, our fishermen, our et cetera, long list of people who use our waters and say, okay, which part of these waters can we not use? So the whole objective is to take a look at, what's left? There's a lot of water. So what's left and what can be done in those waters? And that's really what we're trying to establish. And I equate it to how municipalities prepare for economic growth. Like if you look at places that have, large growth, like I'm thinking, just outside of Halifax, et cetera, a lot of the work that municipalities do to set the stage includes infrastructure, right? So it's sewer, it's water, they extend, and they look at those kinds of services in order to entice economic development. Well, this particular project is very similar. Like, we're trying to set the stage, but except it's on sea and not on land. So it's a little challenging, it's a little interesting. And so that's where we are. We're still, early stages on that, but there is a meeting tomorrow where we're gonna be looking to share some of the data information that we might have at the district planning and what the province may have at their level. And then so we'll see where that goes. So the people engaged in that project include Charlene Leblanc and Alex D'Entremont and myself and the provincial representatives. And I'm sure the warden has a thing or two to say about aquaculture, having come back recently from a trip.
It's amazing. It's amazing what's going on in especially Norway and Ireland, especially Norway. We visited a processing plant there where they process salmon. And the guy told us that what we raise in salmon in Canada would keep their fish plant operating for 2.5 days. That's how much fish they process there. Tons and tons and tons. It's quite a fish plant, I tell you. We had it was busy. First 2-3 days we hardly any sleep at all. First 24 hours we didn't. But it was good, a good trip. It's good to see what they do. The amount of fish that they raise there, and the number of cages that they have, and the farms, and it's hard to, But like they say, it takes a small footprint to raise fish. It's not like a farm where you need a lot of land to raise a few animals, The footprint is very small, what you use on land. And most of it there is on in the sea. It's not land-based. But I have some information. I did give some to Charlene. I left a flyer with you, and I took it back.
Thank you.
But it's on their website. All the information is on their website, And Charlene and I met with Murray Hill this week. He just wanted to come. He was on the tour with us on the mission, and he just wanted to He was going around checking with the mayors and wardens, you know, what we thought of the mission and how it went and all this stuff. So it's interesting. It's mind-boggling.
Huge.
Yeah, huge is right. Did you have anything else that you wanted to touch on the...
Just the Airport Corporation, I think you're aware.
Yes.
I'm attending some meetings this week to assist. I don't know what my title is there, but they'll probably make one up. It's to coordinate the whole, some of the economic development files that are happening. We're trying to pull that away from our operations manager because he's a manager of operations. And so a lot of these files have been ongoing for a while. It was difficult for us to unload the files to the REN in completion. So I think my role there is transitional. So that might be a month or year, I don't know. But anyway, so I'll be going to meetings this week with an interest of one of the projects is to take a look at restoring passenger service at the airport. That's important for a number of reasons. Altitudes East is a conference that has all the players, all the big players, and so that's what's happening this week. So I'll be attending that, and the REN has taken on like some pretty big projects from the airport, which I think is great. That's what the regional economic development organization recognizes, that the airport is a regional asset. That's why they're working on it. So I think that's important. The municipal administration building, there's an update. So we did receive the final report from PDI Engineering Group regarding the estimated cost to retrofit the building. So due to the timing of when it was received, staff hasn't had the opportunity to do a full report for you. So, but we didn't want to hold on to the information until our committee of the whole meeting. So I believe you've all received a copy of that report through email. At least I think you have. Anyway, so the report in summary identifies, you know, the deficiencies of this building. No, shaking your head. Okay. All right, well, there you have it. All right, well, you will see it. We received it earlier, so the summary of that is here. And so the review is to present. Okay, so the summary, the report identifies the deficiencies of the building. Most of them relate to code and accessibility. Well, that's not new. We've been talking about that. That's not new information. So assuming inflation of 2% is what they do, their calculation, the result of possible replacement repair costs, and what I mean by replacement repair is this building, retrofitting this building, which probably should say retrofit repair, is slightly over $2 million. So I think that number is probably a little high. I think that they erred on the side of caution there. So it is an estimate at a high level, so we have to keep that in mind. You know, we're dealing with a high level estimate right now. This is not people competing for price. We're not there. So the actual expenses could be higher or lower, but I think more likely lower. The major components of this cost include three things, or four, I guess. The need to expand, as we are unable to use the basement for office space. So this has been mentioned before. This is a bit of a problem, is that because this is an assembly building, the National Building Code forces us to meet code standards that are different than would be at your house. So when you do an L or an expansion on your home, you're not expected to go backwards and fix everything to code. You're grandfathered. But when you're in an assembly building, which is this building, that's what it's coded or qualifies for, you have to go back and actually fix the deficiencies, the code deficiencies. So the biggest issue around that is the basement, because the basement ceiling does not meet code. And so other than actually lifting the building 3 or 4 feet, which I think it can be done at a cost.
Dig down.
You could dig down. You could do that. I don't think we assessed that one, but from that perspective, the conclusion of the engineer was that you would no longer be able to use that space for staff. So we have staff in the basement, and we also have our emergency office, emergency operations center in the basement, as well as shared leased space to our district planning commission. So we would have to, if we were to replace that square footage, the cost of that is included in this retrofit. Now, the good news is that if you expand it, that's new, right? Whatever you do expanded, you know, has a life cycle of probably 50 to 60 years, right? It's brand new. But, you know, of course, what you do to the existing facility has a lower life cycle because you actually are retrofitting an older building. So the other two areas, of course, the whole point of us looking at this is accessibility. So we would have to, and the solution that they recommend is an elevator. There might be savings in the way we do that, knowing that we're not able to use the basement anymore.
My question.
Right. So
why
so
are
so.
With an elevator?
Well,
if you're not using the basement, you can't.
Yeah,
just questioning.
You still have to get to that level. So you could do that in a different way, which I think would reduce the cost. I think you'd have to at least do a lift. You wouldn't be able to do it with a walkway. We've already established that we don't have the ability to do that. So in an expansion, you might be clever and you might be able to do that in a way that's more efficient, knowing that you're expanding. Okay, that's why I say that's on the high end, that number's on the high end. So new parking lot, obviously if we're going to expand, there's only one place we can go is into the parking lot. The parking lot's at end of life anyway, not too concerned. So if we're gonna do that, then way to go. So the parking would be, of course, it would be further into the property. And then the fire rating reconstruction for fire separation, that's a big deal too. And so we could use the basement for storage. That's not an issue. We just couldn't have staff operate in that building. So all of those things, again, the price is difficult to land. And so we could probably, depending on what council wants to do, and keep in mind, you don't have a full report in front of you, and we have said we want the community engaged in that process also. So we have a timeline that we want to bring a report to you and then subsequently bring that information to the public. The other cost is the consideration to construct a new facility. And so what they estimate is that would be about $263 per square foot. Now that's typically an all-in number. So if you were to look at a building of 8,000 square feet, the estimated cost would be $2.1 million.
It would be a turnkey. I just turn the key and you win.
Well, it would be a new building. So the advantages of that, of course, is that the design would be the way that you would design it in a way that might be more efficient or whatever, because we have inefficiency issues here. And so if that was an option, then obviously you can alter your cost based on how big you do it, and you can alter your cost based on how you build it. You know, you can have two-story, you can have it in a hill, you can have it all in one. So depending on what you look at, the cost is impacted. Generally speaking, if you have something on a hill, like in Clare, the municipality of Clare is a perfect example of that, is generally much less expensive to construct because you're able to take advantage of the slope, right? So anything two levels is generally cheaper than all in one level, but then all in one level, you don't need an elevator, right? So pros and cons. And again, that will be presented in a more comprehensive way. But I know this is something that we want to be talking about because it is a community issue, and it's a council issue, and it's an issue we've been talking about for a while. And we want to be very open about that. So and that's it. So that's what we have. Obviously, the report, along with other observations internally, will come to you as a council. I think that's a lot of information.
High level.
It's a good thing that was high level, right? So I don't know if there are any questions at this point, or whether you want additional information in anticipation of that report, whether there are things that are burning inside of you now that you'd like for us to include in that report. We're all ears.
Councillor Surratt.
I'll go to the Yarmouth International Airport. I'm surprised that you mentioned, and that's my perspective, that you mentioned about air service. After the, to make a business case, after we've had two different types. I guess the board still thinks there's a business case to be made. I know you're quite involved in that. And, you know, the biggest thing I've heard around having air service was it's so much cheaper to drive in to Halifax. That's always, are you crazy? $300 to go to Halifax, you know, on a plane, blah, blah, blah. You know, I certainly can understand if there was cargo service with the lobsters and that, but, you know, I'm very surprised that they're looking at that, but maybe there is a business case, I guess, that you can see where it's chewed up so much money over the couple of times they tried to make a go at it. But, you know, I'm hopeful there is. But I'm just surprised that they're looking at that. Does it surprise you, or you might be pushing for that yourself?
No, it doesn't surprise me. I'll tell you exactly what the motivation is. It's not just about passenger service. It's actually about the fact that an airport, if it's going to obtain federal funding from what's called ACAP, it has to be a small airport with regular passenger service. So there are benefits beyond just the transportation. What we're hopeful is that, you know, the last two times that we've attempted this before, you know, the Air Nova days, we were not associated with a big time operator. And so some of the challenges that I think our community saw was, you know, you can fly to Portland at a fairly reasonable price, then what, right? So you couldn't plan your entire vacation, and this is not to offend anyone that has come in and tried to make a go. The Portland flight actually moved a lot of people. The first time we did it was just, it was too often. And the other challenge was, of course, that, again, you didn't have that link. So what we're looking to achieve is to try to find some of the big operators to say, look, you know, if you're into Yarmouth and you've got an 18 passenger flight that's going to either St. John's, doesn't have to go to Halifax, right? You can go to Halifax, St. John's, Moncton, and then connect further, right? So we think there might be a business model that works there, because it's not just Yarmouth at that point. If you're planning a vacation that's multiple days, if you're in Bridgewater or if you're in Liverpool, it might be cheaper for you to drive to Yarmouth, you know, and not pay all the fees and not have to stay necessarily. So there's a lot of factors in play. Like, our catchment area is a little larger. If we're thinking, okay, this is international travel, this is actually not just going to Halifax, this is going beyond. And there are actually a lot of people in this community, in the county, in all three counties, that do exactly that. I think we dealt with a local travel agency and got information. It's astounding how many tickets are sold to go down south. It's blows you away how many flights. And so yes, that's seasonal, but, you know, generally that those flights go out of Moncton, Toronto, and Halifax. And if it's done off season, it's only Toronto. So you have to get there. You know, so there are opportunities. You know, I think. You know, there are lessons that have been learned.
Well, that's a great answer. I thank you for that. I will just hold it. Thank you.
Yes, thank you. Councillor Muse.
Going back to the building, you mentioned 8,000 square feet. I know we had discussed that we would ask someone to kind of tell us what do we need. And is that where that figure came from? Were we told that we'd need about an 8,000 square foot building to accommodate what we our requirements?
That's a great question. I think that, yes, we asked an architect to come in, local architect, to come in and say, look, this is what we need right now. Take a look, do the square footage, figure out how much we need. It's close to that number. It depends on what you intend to do in the building. It can be smaller.
Okay.
It can be smaller. I think 8,000... I think his work, and I don't have it in front of me, unfortunately, I think his work indicated that it was less than 8,000, but it was close to 8,000.
Okay.
So my best guess today is like 7,500, right? But again, that it depends on what you want to do, and if you, assuming you are constructing new, you know, we also have to take a look at, well, what other buildings do we have? Can we make the footprint smaller? What can mm-hmm. we do, right? So. I think that it's not an unreasonable number, 8,000,
right,
in terms of what he
yeah.
did in his search.
Because you just don't, I think when you're going that route where you're going to have new construction or even expanding, that you don't want to plan on your basic need today. Like, you've almost got to look at where are we going? Like, what, you know, what's the expansion? What's going to happen in the next 5-10 years? Are we going to need an extra? And then if you don't build it now, then, but then again, you've got to look at what, you know, do you, how far ahead do you plan? Like, you know what I mean? Like, can't build for something that you might need in 20 years. You don't know what's going to happen. But anyway, I just wondered because you had used that figure and I knew we had discussed that.
So. It's close to that figure. Yeah. I believe his was a little lower. The other thing that his figure included was an emergency operations center. Yeah. I'm not convinced that that should be in a municipal admin building. Yeah. There are other other buildings that are being contemplated for construction in the very near future that could probably accommodate that, and that's at least 500 square feet, right. 400 or 500. So again, there are ways to keep it smaller. To your point around, you don't want to build too small and then regret, you know, that might play into your design choice. You know, certain designs are easier to expand than others, and so maybe you don't construct it now, but you understand that there's the potential to add another section and you plan for that. So that's another way to anticipate what could happen, right?
Because I know since it's been published that in the papers said that the municipality of Argyle is actually looking at the building. I don't know, it came from some of our meetings, but it wasn't the paper.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, when that comes out, people start talking. And,
right. Well, on the issue of amalgamation, I can only say that I think that there's always a perception that amalgamation means that a bunch of jobs get shredded, and that has not been the case in any of the amalgamations, either forced or unforced. I think there are efficiencies gained, and there are positions that get lost, but not to the extent that people might imagine. So some of the efficiencies aren't actually human resources.
Yeah.
There are other efficiencies. And we must be live. Somebody's calling about the building. we still have to provide a basic service in the community, regardless of whether we think there's going to be an amalgamation.
Yeah, I think what I hear more than anything else is, you know, if you need a building, don't waste your money on an old building. No. You know, that's what I hear.
And when you're looking at the costs, there's in here.
Yeah.
From, you know, from what you just told us. So it's going to be so close to one another.
You know, I just want to add the caveat that these numbers are really, they're. You know, we really have to dig into them a little bit because I don't want to. I think there are probably the thing about an old building being retrofitted is you don't know what you don't know, right? And so there might be costs in here that shouldn't be there, but there might be costs that aren't there. So that's the difficulty of old. I mean, I don't think that's not really anything earth shattering. I guess that's the one advantage of new is that, you know, you have a pretty good idea what you're going to get. It doesn't mean doesn't have its challenges, either one. I think, you know, what council has to look at is whether or not it's ready to make a decision around retrofit versus expansion. I think that has been generally established.
Yeah.
But anyway.
Okay. Is this your rep?
I just answered to Councilor Muses on the if I've heard anything on the building or amalgamation. I've heard quite a bit, and people are saying, you know, I guess the same as you've heard, that, you know, if we're going to be joining or if something happens down the road, where whether we're forced or we do it on our own, that building a new building is certainly not the right way to go, and the taxpayers don't need this extra burden. They've got enough expenses. That's one of the huge things that I've been hearing. And I, when I say huge, I would say I've had nothing under 15 people. To me, that's quite a bit to me. On the other side of the coin, I'd like just to maybe mention, Councilor Muse, that you mentioned about the building, a new building, and retrofitting an old, about the same price. Well, I shouldn't say I don't agree with you, but maybe if you look at the full picture that at least I see, you know, do we need an elevator on a retrofit? I mean, nobody can go downstairs for that elevator, as Councilor Muse has already suggested, could maybe be changed. And so that would drop that cost down on expansion, you know, on the cost of retrofit. We own the property here. We own the land next to the parking lot. We also own that. So, you know, costs on land would be less. So, you know, I'm hearing a lot of people, if there's anything positive, it's, you know, if we do need to move, to make a move, you know, let's go the cheaper of the two options, which would be maybe make you know, a little extension of 20 by 20, you know. No, not 20 by 20. No. But make a little extension, you know, something that would fit our needs, and instead of spending all that money, because possibly down the road, we would be going with the county, possibly. Anyhow, that's what I'm hearing. Thank you.
Thank you. Anything else on the CEO's report? Not, we'll go on to other business. First item is tourism FM transmitter project. Do you want to report on that, CAO?
Very quickly, yeah. Charlene is here. Yes. If you have any questions specifically about the project, this is a project that we had a bit of a dream, and we took a look at, you know, what are ways that we can market in a very unique way our area, and to take advantage of the Nova Star or the ferry service anyway. And so the project, a lot of the work has been led by Charlene, where, you know, it contemplates an FM station where the local tourism operators tell their story about the region. And so I don't know, I mean, you've gone into Halifax and you see those FM signs, right? So this would be people parked. You know, you got them for 2 hours, right? They're parked there, they're looking around, they're looking at their iPad, or if they're smart, their BlackBerry. And so, sorry, did I say that out loud? Anyway, sorry, that's not right. Anyway, so we'll keep going. Anyway, so they would tune into the radio, and then you would hear stories, right? So you can imagine that it might be, you know, I won't use Lucien as an example, but it might be, you know, the tuna tournament that's telling a story about the biggest fish landed, or, you know, and so it's telling a story of our region. And so brilliant idea. I mean, it really, it's a captive audience there. And so Charlene's team, you know, engaged those that are in this business, and they're, you know, pumped about it. And we, you know, went to Portland, invested some time and energy and money to determine whether or not it could happen on both ends, because from our perspective, it has to happen to Portland.
That's right.
Right? And so, mm-hmm. So there's a bilateral, there's very positive comments around this project. And so Charlene has done such a good job on this one. She wants to make sure that it gets done right. So she wants to maintain a leadership role. But we also think, quite rightly, that this project belongs with YASTA. Because it isn't just about Argyle, it's about the region, and we know that we want to attract people in our region and in other regions that we invest in and partner with. So the recommendation that Charlene has made is to maintain a leadership role, but to bring this project to YASTA and say, look, here's an opportunity for you to actually do something and it not cost you money, and that results in a pretty unique marketing opportunity. And so that I would definitely support Charlene's recommendation on this. We've incurred about $2,000 in expenses, and which we look to recover. because it's a situation where we're selling ads, and so if we're going to invest money to give a project to somebody else, we would expect that as part of that we would get a recovery of our costs. So that's the recommendation in front of you. And if there are any questions about the project itself, I think it's well described in the document, but Charlene, I'm sure, is happy to answer any questions you might have.
Charette.
Charlene, if I could direct this to you, just a quick question. I'm looking here, this, it says at the end, this equals $18,000, of which 75% would go to Media Voice. 25%, $4,500 of all production fees collected, then go to the local hub, which would be the YASTA, right? Now, that's if everything is sold. This is my question. That is if 100% of the spots are sold. Have you looked at, is this sellable? Is that, do you think those spots, I guess that's my question. Am I being a pessimist, maybe a little pessimist, maybe? Do you think those spots, obviously you do, you wouldn't have put it here, but it seems, you know, I wonder. At $400 a pop, it would be $400 for a season for anybody to do that spot on there. I was reading there. Let's say that I would want to advertise. So $400 for the season. So that $400, from your perspective, that should be sellable then.
I think so.
Okay, good. That was my question, what you thought of that. Was it doable, or was it pie in the sky? Or, no, it is, you believe it's doable.
And that's Media Voices that gave us the rate. That's what they would normally sell for 45 to a minute.
Sure, that's right. That's right. I just thought maybe you'll only get 50% of it. If you only do 50% of the ads, then the after cost goes up, right? Or whoever's sponsoring this. So if you don't sell as many ads, if you don't sell the full program, then somebody's going to have to absorb the cost, because your cost is still going to be $22,000 or something like that. Anyhow, you know what I'm saying, but you feel it can be sold. That's, thank you.
It's not something that's going to put us, it's going to sustain itself.
Yeah.
Whether they sell $15,000 worth of ads, it's still going to be sustainable.
Thank you.
Councilor Lebedon?
I think it's a great idea. I'll make the motion that we present the FM transmitter FM transmitter project to the ASTA board and request that our CDO be the lead and administer the project.
CEO?
CDO.
CEO, CDO, okay. All right, thank you. You have a mover and a seconder, any more comment? Okay. We have a mover and a seconder. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carried. Road name change request, Dirt Road. Who brought that? You did? No. Your district. So do we send in with both names, or how do we do that normally?
We generally submit the one name.
The one name.
But
and
I think
if come
you,
back?
If you, yeah, I mean, I think we would execute the second name. I don't
yeah.
think we'd have to bring it back.
No, of course not. Okay. A motion, that's a motion, made that a motion, seconded by Councillor Surratt. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carried. Road name request, A&H Road. This one. Okay, that's in Bell Neck, right?
Yeah.
I so moved that we send this to Transportation Department for the name to be E&H Quatcher Road, as requested on this.
Is it A&H Road, yeah?
A&H Road, sorry.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Thank you.
Second. Any questions or comments? Not all those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Nay. Motion carried. Mariners Center board member appointments. Okay, just get a look at speak on this CAO.
So we're just looking for a motion to approve the three names. The three names were brought to the Mariners Center board as part of the agreement. That was what we were asked to do, and the Mariners Center approved the three members, and so it's to you to approve these three members as your representatives on the new Mariners Center board.
I so move.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carried. Relief of interest. Request for relief of interest. That's on the tax bill, right?
This is on one account. This is in accordance with the legislation for wind turbines. There was an interest applied in error. The bill was submitted because of the prorated a year, because they have 6 months from the time that the wind turbine starts spinning to be billed. We billed it in an appropriate way, but the interest was added in, and it should not have been added on this property. I'm recommending it be written off as it's added in error.
Okay. Can we have a...
So moved on the relief interest on this account in the amount of $489.28.
Second.
And that's interest only. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carried. Voluntary disposition of property.
That's in my district.
What?
I think that's in my district.
Yes.
It's a house in Upper Westport. We had talked about it before, where he had his permit for demolition way before the assessment came in.
The permit.
The house could not be torn down because of the winter that we had, because David the Fry couldn't get to the place where this person wanted to put the debris, which he did this at his own expense, at no expense to anybody else or his own expense. And then he couldn't get it done in time when the assessment came in. They assessed it, but he tore it down shortly after. And I think something should be done with this resident that there must be some kind of options to amend the bylaw in question here to help this person out.
What is there anything we can do?
Well, as I had mentioned when this first came up, the MGA is clear around when it's involuntary disposition that you can create a policy to address that. We have a policy for, you know, in the cases of involuntary, like fire destruction, etc. This is a voluntary demolition. We don't have the authority to write off the taxes on this property. We're not provided that authority under the Act. I don't know how else to put it. It's unfortunate. This situation is unfortunate because it is true. The permit was, the person did come in to get a permit to demolish, but didn't actually demolish until February. And so the PVSC rules on assessment apply in December, December 1st, in fact.
Yeah.
And so what they look at is what's on the property on December 1st. Well, unfortunately, 2 months later, that property is substantially different. And so I'm sure he fully expected, when came time, that his taxes would be adjusted. So it was a bit of an unpleasant surprise. Yeah. And unfortunately, we don't have the legislative authority. Now, we can, if you're adamant that we re-examine the issue and from a legal perspective, I'm happy to consult with our solicitor a second time and see if there's something that we missed. Because I can, I'm hearing your passion, and I understand exactly the issue. I'm not sure that that's gonna have a different result, unfortunately. But we're happy to do that for you if that's what you want.
Well, I would like for something to be done. If something that, there's nothing council here that will, us at council, we can't change something to, I don't know what we can do, but I'd like to see council, I'd like to help this person, and I know that council sees it also, that there must be something that we can do to, and the only reason that it wasn't gone is because it couldn't go because of where he put the stuff on his land, off on the Black Barn Road, which was, he got a permit for that and everything was done, but the contractor couldn't get in there because of the snow and the winter that we had last year. Because he would have been gone. I know this person, and it would have been gone. His contractor couldn't do it. And that's the only reason why it was there. It's like he said, he wouldn't mind having to pay some, but not the full amount. You know what I'm saying?
We know what you're saying, but from what we're hearing is we legally can't do anything about it.
No, but is there nothing that can be changed?
Well, we can.
MGA, like, I don't know.
Well, yeah. our interpretation of the MGA, of the rules, is that the issue is at the MGA level, right? There's no question. So, if the MGA doesn't allow us to do it, then we can't do it through policy or otherwise. So that's the problem. The problem is up higher. Now we can bring this issue to the UNSM. Right? I mean, the UNSM is now conducting an MGA review with the province, and this issue can certainly be raised at that level. What we can do that can't happen. Well, we can advise them today, but you know how that happens, right? I mean, by the time those changes are made, it's years. What we can do today is re-examine the MGA and see if there's any wiggle room. And if there is, then we can bring it back here.
You need a motion for that?
Not really.
I don't think so.
No.
I don't think so.
I would appreciate if you get together with our solicitor and see what, if something can be done to relieve this a bit.
Yeah,
it's not total.
I understand. I hear your concern because I've had a conversation with this person,
yes.
And it's not equitable. Like, it doesn't feel fair. Unfortunately, it's the rules that we have in front of us. But it's like, in the interest of trying to help this gentleman, we will take a second look.
Because we have things going on in our municipality that we ask of people to do something, like with houses that are, you know, tanked, and they don't do it.
Yeah.
But this person here, this house was in perfect shape.
Yeah.
And the only reason that he brought it down, because his parents died, and he didn't want anybody, you know, rent the house or anything. He just, and he cleaned up the lot, as you can see.
Mm.
It's perfect. Okay. Got the lawn there again. And, you know, he would have done it. But if, you know, I would appreciate it very much, and I'm sure he would do it.
Okay. Well, the best we can do.
Just a factual, not that it'll help him with this, with the 14, 15, or 15, 16 tax year, but has he had PVSC come in and reassess the property for the upcoming tax year?
I couldn't.
Perhaps that's one thing that you can do just to make sure that he gets it properly reassessed, or that he be on the lookout, of course, when the assessment comes out in January, make sure that he does his appeal if it hasn't been reassessed at that time. Now, like I said, it doesn't help him retroactively, but it will help him moving forward.
Before the 1st of December?
Before the 1st of December, absolutely.
Yes. Yeah.
The permitting process will pick up on the issue that. So
yes.
Should repair itself next year, but that's not really the issue. But we have to keep our eye on it in case something gets missed, because things get missed. So when the
Councilor LeBlanc.
I agree with Councilor Murphy. I hear that staff hears that it's unfortunate and there's nothing we can do. And by the sounds of it, legally our hands are tied, but the system is evidently flawed. I mean, if a gentleman has to pay taxes on a property that wasn't there, there's a flaw in the system. And it may be easy for council, staff, whatever, to brush this under the doormat because it's a minimal amount of taxes. I know it was tried, and I know basically the MGA says hands are tied, but evidently there's a flaw in the MGA, and I think that should be addressed, definitely addressed, at UNSM level. From my understanding, speaking to this gentleman as well, the taxes have been paid.
Yes.
In fear of, obviously, the repercussions we put in place if you don't pay your taxes. Shouldn't signify that he's necessarily giving up the battle. It's just he feared, obviously, what would happen if he didn't pay his taxes. And he's, of course, doing his due diligence, and he paid them. But however, I don't think the issue should rest here. There was a building, it was gone, and he's paying taxes for the amount of time that it wasn't there. And if it was me, I'd feel exactly how he feels. And I think whatever this council needs to do to raise the issue to UNSM or with, it's not a provincial matter, but it has to be addressed. There's an issue and there's a flaw with the system, and I don't want to see anyone rest until it. I know it's just one person, and it's a shame he had to do it. And it's a shame this is how we had to find out there's a flaw in the system, but this could happen in the future. Someone not paying attention to this meeting or the issue could very well do the exact same thing, and I don't feel that's fair. Kind of like Councilor Murphy raised, where we're trying to tear down derelict houses, not that this one necessarily was, but this gentleman beautified his property on his own expense, and the sort of a slap in the face that this had to happen. So. I'd like staff to, you know, I understand staff did what they could, and you were told, you know, the law is the law, but there's evidently a problem with the law, and I think it has to be raised.
It's happened many times before. It's not the first time. Councillor Surratt.
A couple of things. There's one thing that, I guess maybe this council can take some responsibility on this too. Where one of our, I guess when they do give a permit out, a demolition permit out, and this was brought up by our CAO, that we council and our staff, I guess, if when they get a demolition permit, if the people are told, don't forget by, is it December the 1st or January the 1st, that this has to be taken down or you will be paying taxes. And I think, I'm sure our CAO addressed that with the gentleman at Public Works, is just something that was missed. I mean, we don't normally do it, but we are doing it from now on, is what I remember from our last meeting, Alain.
What staff had committed to do was to try to inform the people that are going through this process.
Yes.
So that they at least get into this situation with their eyes wide open.
Yes.
Right, because the other unfortunate occurrence was this gentleman received their assessment in January and had the opportunity to appeal their taxes and did not do that.
Good point.
And so they had an outstanding permit, a demolition permit. They could have easily argued that, and I feel for the gentleman, please don't misrepresent what I'm trying to say here, but he does have an opportunity there. And unfortunately he didn't take that opportunity. Maybe he didn't know about the opportunity. There are many people that don't know about the appeal process. And so I think it is our responsibility to increase the awareness of this situation. No question. Staff will, upon council's request, staff will certainly make requests to the UNSM and other bodies to re-examine the powers that the MGA will allow us to do. Staff will not break the law.
No.
So if the law says, and if we confirm that the law says we have no power in this area, and we take that very seriously, and we think that that's extremely unfortunate for him, we will not act outside of the law.
I'd like to just add something else, Mr. Warden. One thing, like Councillor LeBlanc said, there is a flaw here. And to myself, I stand to be corrected, the huge flaw is PVSC. To get the assessment out, if I got the right word, has to do their assessments early.
Correct.
If this had been done March 31st, which I know is impossible to have the assessment out for April the 1st, it just can't happen.
Yeah.
But if this could be done later on, or I don't know what, but there's a flaw there. They're doing their assessment 4 months earlier or 5 months earlier, four months earlier, you know. And if somebody is demolished between December the 1st and March 31st, gee whiz, it puts the people that do demolish, they have to pay the taxes on, and that's not fair. You know, there is a flaw, as Councillor LeBlanc and Councillor Murphy are bringing up here. And I do support, if we could find something or dig, which I know we will do, we will not go outside the law, I understand that, but anything to help them out, if it's legally possible, let's do it.
Thank you. Councillor Muse?
I'm just wondering, I know what you're saying, Councillor Surrett, but the taxes are based on the year from January, right? I mean, you pay your taxes for the fiscal year, for the calendar year.
No. Fiscal.
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 Fiscal. Fiscal year.
Yeah.
Okay. The same happens in the opposite when someone is building.
Correct.
Okay? So you're building a house that's half done, and you're paying from the time it's assessed, for that whole year, you're paying on a house that's half done, and you finish it by March, and you're not paying taxes on your full house for the rest of the year. You know what I'm saying? I mean, I'm not saying that this is right, what's happened there, but it works to the advantage of some homeowners where they're not paying taxes on a house that's fully. It's fully built. It's they're living in it, but they're paying taxes on a house that's only half built for that year, right? I'm right in saying that. Right?
Absolutely, you could have a house constructed for March 31st.
Yes.
Begun on January 1st. Let's just assume the weather allows you to do that, and you would receive, if you own the property before, you would receive your tax bill for the vacant lot.
Yes,
and so exactly. you're be 7 years.
But you're living
bucks.
In a house for 9 months of the year with no taxes
for the full 12.
House.
In fact,
full 12 it could be. Yeah.
Yes, exactly. Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm not saying that it makes it right that someone who, you know, in his case, now did this property owner realize that it had to be done before? Did he know that the house
don't suppose
be, or you don't know?
No,
he didn't. But I mean, he didn't choose not to do it himself.
Oh,
I mean,
no.
It wasn't done because
it couldn't
be done.
No, it was just an oversight probably on his part. That he thought that where he had the permit for demolition,
that he would have to pay taxes.
Light, like,
exactly, yeah.
And I would have probably done the same thing.
Yeah.
You know, I would have thought the same thing.
And I think what was discussed earlier was that, that people have to be made aware.
Mm-hmm. When you have that, that they have to know that if it's not done, that they are probably going to have to pay taxes. So if the MGA has changed, that's exactly what's going to happen to anybody who falls in that same situation.
That's right.
And whether we'll be able, I mean, I know we can make this, or staff can make suggestions to change that, but there's nothing that says that it will be changed either.
It's beyond our control to change.
You know, for sure.
Yeah.
But at least I think we have to take the
initiative
to at least try so that that doesn't happen again.
Thank you. Next item is the bylaws first reading. Is you or Chris? Go ahead.
So we have attached on the agenda are the five bylaws that have already been presented to you in June. Four of them are for amending, and one of them is for review. So we're going to need, once we go through them, if you wish to approve to pass the first reading, we're going to need a motion for each kind of bunch of law together. So the first one is the interpretation bylaw, which all of the amendments are highlighted in yellow. The wording and the context of the bylaw are taken from the AMA model bylaw policy, model bylaws. So we haven't yet run it through our solicitor, but it's through the AMA model bylaws. And it just generally gives details around specific definitions for all of the bylaws in one bylaw. So it interprets some of the definitions if they're not already in the specific bylaw. The second
bylaw is the building bylaw. So this was fairly outdated and needed a lot of work. So there is no section that's specifically highlighted because everything is completely different. this really great work was done by John Sullivan, the Public Works Department. So they looked at the National Building Code, and obviously the National Building Code, I guess, oversees every bylaw, or they always have to fall back on that if there isn't something in our bylaw that talks specifically about a certain standard. But this talks a lot about specific codes or standards within the municipality as well. So unfortunately, if there is a specific question about a detail in the bylaw, I probably wouldn't be able to answer, but I would definitely find the answer for you from John. So if you look through it, it talks about permitting and the different types of permits, occupancy, demolition that we've been talking about tonight, as well as building. The third bylaw is the enforcement and policies. So this is also a fairly new, more detailed bylaw around the enforcement of our penalties. And the final bylaw for amendment is tax exemptions for nonprofit organizations. So we've added or we've updated the list of charitable organizations that are found on our nonprofit organizations that we exempt the taxes to. And we've also indicated or added that we would review that list every year. So before, it just said that the list in Schedule A would be reviewed, but it never said when. So we're gonna say that it's on a yearly basis. It doesn't mean that something has to change. It's simply just to look over to make sure it's up to date. And also that any amendments wouldn't require, to the Schedule A, wouldn't require a whole bylaw amendment process every year. So it would just simply be looking at that list.
So if somebody departs an exemption, like Nikhil,
That's correct. That's a great example. So next year we wouldn't have to redo the whole entire bylaw. We just do by policy the amendment to the Schedule A to that list. And also it talks about the deadline of when the exemptions would take place. So those are the four that are for amendment, but we also have one which is the annual payment of council, which is for repeal. And the reason why we are choosing to repeal that is because the number one, the annual payment in the bylaw is outdated, and it doesn't necessarily have to be in a bylaw, and we can actually do that within a policy. So we were recommending that the stipend amount paid to the councillors, deputy warden, and warden, along with the general policy that we have around who can attend UNSM and FCM, which is anyone, would be put into a policy together. So it would just be generally regarding the payment of council on either conferences or yearly basis. So those were the five. Is there anyone that has any questions either around the process or the specific, any specific bylaw? Is there anything you want to add, Alain?
Only that on the building bylaw, we followed the model bylaw that was in most cases, but I think of particular interest to you should be the building bylaw, is that we followed a template that has been determined by AMA. One down. Also that the old bylaw was extremely outdated, mm-hmm. and was actually contrary to the National Building Code, so we needed to change it. This bylaw is a bit more flexible in the sense that it says that the National Building Code is king, and so it's a needed improvement. But that one's the most complicated one, right? So.
Okay, so we want motions on all of these individual.
That's correct, to accept the first reading so that we can continue the process of approving the bylaws and go to the second reading.
Okay, yeah. So.
I'd like to move that we
the first reading.
The first reading of the, so we have to do it individually?
That's correct, yeah.
Is that the interpretation, bylaw number one? Then?
That's correct.
That we approve first reading of the bylaw number one interpretation.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Excuse me. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, nay. Motion carried.
I move.
The second bylaw.
I move.
Okay. All moved and seconded. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, nay. Motion carried. Number two, number three. 19.
I move bylaw number 19A, enforcement and penalties.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carried. And bylaw 28, tax exemptions.
I move.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carried.
To
make the begin the process of repealing that bylaw. Yeah.
I'd like to move that we start the process of repealing the annual payment of council.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carried. That brings us to number 10 on the agenda, correspondence and for information. Most of this is for information. Future orders to demolish, notice, Nova Scotia Lotteries and Casino Corporation, summary of results, and 2014-15 July building permit comparison. And 14-15 August building permit comparisons. And the EMO exercise of September the 12th. this is coming up shortly.
It's coming Saturday, right?
Mr. Warden, do you understand from that part that are we supposed to meet here? Is reading what she's got there, does she's kind of asking us, but are we supposed to be meeting here? What do you understand? Maybe see it all? It seems like she wants us to be here for this emergency.
Yeah, she's hoping to involve warden and council.
As part of the exercise, they are, or they would like EMO to go through the process of declaring a local state of emergency.
EMO.
And that's correct. And to declare that local state of emergency, they need council to do that.
Yes.
So she's extending the invitation for councillors to participate in the exercise by coming to the council chambers to go through the process of how that would work.
Okay.
It's not, I guess, necessary, but it's just extending the invitation to you.
Yes.
No time frame or anything like that?
I guess trying to keep as much of the exercise realistic as possible.
Yes.
They're
yeah.
trying not to, but the exercise will be taking place in the morning of September 12th. So how it typically, according to Janine Works, his council is summoned to the council chambers by either the warden or the CAO, depending on what the emergency is and what's needed.
Yeah.
I'm going to send my regrets. I won't be here on the 12th.
That's fine.
Neither will I.
Yeah, and she understands that she just wanted to extend.
Well, we're all invited, and hopefully as many of us can come here. As we can, anyway.
Yeah.
But they want us here.
Here.
Not in Kent.
That's correct.
Yeah.
Yeah. Here.
Yeah, yeah.
I was very well in Kent.
Mm-hmm. Unless you want to.
What do you mean? What's going on in Kent?
Yeah.
Yeah.
We don't know nothing.
Who's Kent? Who's Kent? Okay, next item is immigration community conversation. And the Mariners Center needs assessment final report. 56 pages. I'm sure you've all read that. Any questions or comments on any of those items or other than the EMO, I guess we've discussed already? If not, we'll go on to financial requests, district community grants. And the first one is the Village Historique Acadien, La Nouvelle Écosse.
Okay,
it's yours, Deputy Warden.
That would be mine.
I guess it's written in French, but I will loosely translate. It's from Roger D'Entremont, the manager, the director of the village, and they're looking for a district community grant for $500 for Le Passport, which is an initiative that they've got to discover Acadia, your roots from yesterday and today. And it's they partner with Port Royal, L'Église Sainte Marie, Grand Pré, Fort Han. And a few others, and it's an initiative to get the people to, you know, have a passport and go to every place and get your passport stamp. And at the end, I'm just trying to remember, you can submit your passport and a chance to win something.
Yes.
So,
yeah.
And we've supported this in the past. I make the motion that we support it.
Moved and seconded to approve the request. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carried. Next one is the Tuna Museum Quilters. Councillor LeBlanc?
There's an organized group of quilters that meet at the Tuna Museum in Wedgeport. They often they often pay for the quilting material out of their own pockets and often donate these quilts to families in need or for various fundraisers, and they're applying for $500 to our grants, to district community grants, sorry. So I'll make the motion that we accept.
Second. Moved and seconded. All those in favor signify by saying aye. Contrary-minded, nay. Motion carried. Yeah, I guess they give them all away, huh?
Yeah.
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 They do tremendous work.
Yeah, they do.
Comité para el Cielo de Westport.
The Comité para el Cielo de Westport is, again, applying for $500 to a district community grant for a new chimney, although although a religious organization can apply to our grants organization, they can, however, apply to our district community grants. So I'll make the motion that Comité para el Cielo de Westport receive their $500 for a new chimney.
All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carried. Notice of motion by councillors. Does anybody have a notice of motion for a future meeting?
Just one. There's at least one.
Councillor Albright?
I just want to mention that at the next meeting, I'm still gathering some information, but I'm going to bring an issue that's going on in the Quinnan area. I've talked about it before. During periods of heavy rain, their phone lines, their landlines, are not always working, and cell service is next to nothing there as well. And it's been an issue. It's been ongoing, and I'm just doing a little bit more digging of information. I'll come back, but I'm going to be looking probably for a letter of support sent to Alliant to see what they can do to kind of help us out here. Okay? Thank you.
Thank you. And Councillor Bourque?
I just wanted to probably talk to a future meeting about the signage. It was brought to my attention that all signs have not been translated yet, French and English. So I just want to bring that up to
that's
see
Richard.
Where we're at.
That's for Richard. He calls that China.
Okay.
He said, I see these signs. He said, it says channel in front of him.
Yeah, channel.
That's all I have.
Okay, thank you. Yes, I've noticed. I've seen a few signs lately. Yeah. Thank you. And next thing on the agenda is question period. Does anybody have any questions?
We're good.
Good. So I guess we'll entertain a motion to recess and go in camera.
No.
Second.